Welcome everyone to this week's founder chat. I'm speaking with Anka Chan, who is the co-founder of Ruth. And there's a story behind Ruth that I will let Anka tell. And I'm really excited to get into that. I love what you've been doing over the past 6 months, a year, whatever that's looked like, and the different kind of directions you've ended up going in, I think is really, really cool. And if anyone is not familiar with Ruth, I absolutely love your tagline. So I have it over here. So if I ever look over here, I apologize for that. I'm looking at my laptop, but it's to ruthlessly, love play on words. So to ruthlessly make sustainable menstrual products an easy choice. Love, love, love this so much. So we met Anka first earlier this year. No, not this year. We're in 2021 now. So it was in 2020.
Yeah.
And I'm kind of losing track of time, apparently. I think it was about mid-year that you were pitching at one of our events, and everyone just kind of went absolutely gaga over what you were doing. We knew we wanted to be able to highlight what you're doing and talk about it more. And these founder chats, which we launched back in May, I guess, have given this opportunity to have you on here and tell your story. So for those who are not familiar with our founder chats, it's essentially a 30-minute kind of guided conversation. But you in the audience, whether you're here live with us, hello everyone, or if you're on IGTV or YouTube later, please do feel free to jump in, comment, ask questions, and we'll make sure to have that incorporated into our conversation here today. So aside from that, I'm Melanie, and I'm one of the managing partners at Volition. So we elevate entrepreneurship in global ecosystems through partner programming, coaching, and events, like that's the one that we met Anka at. So in terms of how this will go, we're going to learn about the origin story of Ruth. We're going to talk about some of Anka's entrepreneurial journey, how we can support Ruth and Anka going forward. So I'm really excited to dig in. So I'll stop talking now. You've heard the tagline. Probably you're just so excited to hear what is this, like, ruthlessly making sustainable menstrual products. What is this? Tell me more if you're anything like me. So I'm going to hand it over to you, Anka. And just typically I'd love to know a little bit about kind of like, let's just like place you in Ruth. Like, who are you at Ruth, and what is the origin story? If you are part of the origin story, kind of how it came to be. So just a little bit of that kind of juicy origin element of you and you in Ruth.
Yeah, for sure. So Ruth is an organization where we're making sustainable menstrual products, and we're focusing first on disposable menstrual pads that are biodegradable and compostable. So our vision for this was, we noticed that the sustainable products that are available, like reusable products, are a little bit inaccessible sometimes. People might not be able to keep up with the hygiene cleaning that's necessary for reusable products. But we noticed that, like, with the disposable pads, a lot of them out there are not eco-friendly. They're made of harmful plastics. So we saw that there has to be something better. There has to be, like, something in the middle. So that's why we were so passionate about creating a solution that is convenient for people who menstruate, and is also sustainable and eco-friendly. Yeah. And for myself, yeah, I first got launched into the area of menstrual hygiene through a project at Enactus at my university. Mm-hmm. It was called Hempact, and we were creating hemp-based menstrual pads. And that's what we worked on, and I was focused really heavily on the product development, research development side of things. And from there, we worked for about 2 years on it, kind of treating it as an extracurricular, and then became more serious in April of 2020, where we officially incorporated. And through that journey, we got connected to different manufacturers. We got connected to a consultant from Johnson & Johnson that we were working with. But we realized that kind of there were some barriers to creating a hemp-based product that we felt like we were not yet in the best position to tackle in terms of kind of like the capital resources or like the finances that would be necessary to fund this whole intensive product development. So that's why we shifted gears a little bit. So in December of 2020, and then moving into January of 2021, we officially launched as Ruth, because we wanted to incorporate being able to use other sustainable materials that are out there and expand, not solely focused on hemp, though we do love hemp and we purport its environmental benefits. We know that there are other sustainable materials that we're really excited about using and that are a lot more accessible when it comes to manufacturing for like the immediate time being.
I love this so much. I remember first seeing kind of this intersection of women's health and environmentalism, or like having that kind of product, sustainable product mindset, and that kind of that intersection I first saw, I feel like not even that long ago. I think like Diva Cup was like the first thing that was like, oh, it's gonna be a thing. And then there was kind of like some boxes that came out, and I remember getting one to do like one of those unbox videos that people, I don't know if they still do them, but I did one, and it was just like, it was so amazing, but the products were like, they felt awful. Not to like too much information the situation, but there's just like so many barriers, like you're saying, for any woman who, or sorry, anyone who menstruates, who are using these products, and we're trying to be sustainably minded in doing so. It was very difficult, and it just felt like, you know what, I can't, like I give up, I don't know what to do. So I'm curious about like what, since you started this, it sounds like in the last 2 to 3 years, did you say it was about 3 years ago that you first conceptualized it? I'd be curious about like what that journey has been like as an entrepreneur, but specifically in this like intersection, and like the like what you've seen shift, or kind of like, yeah, what's that journey of being working in this particular area been like?
I think in the very beginning, so I went into this knowing zero about creating a menstrual product. And I think the more that I worked on it, obviously, the more aware I became of what's happening in the industry at large. And I think what I've realized in the past couple of years, we've seen so much more conversation around menstruation, which is really exciting. And I think even being more conscious and aware of the language surrounding menstruation has been really good, even for myself to learn about like how to be inclusive with the language. So seeing like people who
People
menstruate or
menstruate.
people who have periods instead of like specifying women only, because as we know, not only women menstruate, there are people who don't identify as women but also menstruate. And I think like that was a big learning thing for me to realize like, oh, this is something that like we have to be aware of. So I think the conversation has been really positive. But that being said, actually, like working to create the products, I think we've kind of sensed that when you're entering an industry that where like the product manufacturing matters a lot, there are so many hurdles to figure out because like approaching it with an idea is great, but then the execution is obviously what matters the most, right? Like making sure you have a product that actually works. So I would say there's definitely been ups and downs with like the testing and then figuring out like, yeah, what are the standards when it comes to menstrual products and like how are they classified by the government? Because what was interesting is we realized that it made sense for us to focus on pads first because tampons are considered menstrual devices. So there's like an extra level of regulation that they go through. Like medically inserted. So just like little things like that, where
Oh,
it's
fascinating.
because you want those things to be regulated for sure. But lots of things to learn. And I think overall the sense is that it is a positive shift that we're entering into 2021 with.
Absolutely. Very cool. Hi, Robox. Thanks for waving. Everyone who's in here, please do wave. It's really great to see, or Robox, sorry. Still pronouncing things. Still, I'm still learning, and also still learned about like this inclusive language from reading your website. Actually, the inclusive language around menstruation as well. It's really, really interesting. I appreciate that you're like putting that intentionality into everything that you do. Okay, so I feel like I have kind of an understanding of where you come from and that journey a little bit. And the last year has been so interesting, and like kind of making that pivot to Ruth, which is very cool. So now that we're in January 2021, you've launched your new brand, which everyone go check out, getruth.ca. I think that's what it is, like all of your social media channels and everything, and your website, getruth.ca. So go check it out, because I know some people were following Hempact. So make sure to get on to getruth.ca and start following that one. And hi to everyone who's saying hello. Great to see you. For sure, very cool. So what does the future of Ruth look like, and like whether that's 2021 or what's kind of your kind of like your big, hairy, audacious goal? What do you see? What's the vision here?
Yeah, so in the very immediate time frame, we're looking to launch our beta testing very soon. So we do have a list of beta testers that we'll be in the process of contacting and reaching out to. So they'll be the first to try the pads and give us their feedback. And hi, Yamila. And we're hoping to be able to collect all the feedback that we get from the beta testers and then actually send them back to our supplier and make sure that we are making any product iterations that are necessary to make the pad the best possible pad it can be. And then following from there, we are still figuring out our plans for whether we will be doing a Kickstarter potentially, or just going straight to doing a launch. And we'll be broadcasting all the updates from our website and from our newsletter. So people can definitely stay in touch there to see exactly what's going to happen next. But the goal is really by the summer to be able to get our products into the hands of people who are interested in making their periods a little bit more sustainable, but not less convenient.
Yes, because I remember that at the pitch event, someone brought up, well, you know, you have these competitors, people who are making underwear that is pads now, and all of these kinds of things. Like, how are you competing in that space? And you were like, well, actually, I can just let you answer that if you want.
Yeah, I mean the way that we're competing in the space is that, a lot of the reusable products, like they require you to put in a lot of care and attention after you use it. And for us, we incorporated all the care and intention on our end so that we're making a product that's easy for the customer. They don't have to wash the pad after, and they can dispose of it knowing that it was made from materials that were sustainable and are able to be compostable as well.
Very cool. So can you put it in your like in Canada? I don't know actually, where are you located?
Right now I'm in Edmonton, and our company is kind of centered in Edmonton.
So is it something that you'd like be able to put in? Do you have a green like the green bin programs in Edmonton? Every
So
city's
right now
different.
we don't. Yeah, I know like the different municipalities have different disposal services. So our city, I think they're in the process of launching some new initiatives where they're changing things up. So I know that we do have a couple of composting facilities around Edmonton where it's like there's like a community compost facility actually. And then I think there are also we used to have an industrial composting facility, but I think things are changing a little bit with that. But yeah, the way that the product would work is that if you have your own composting facility at home, then you could put it in there. And the best way to do it is if like you take off the top sheet and like the backing, but if not, then you can just put it in there and leave it for longer. And yeah, we're
So it
hoping
doesn't.
to get down to composting within 180 days.
Yeah, because I know that some things are also like has to do with the heat element, and like some certain composting facilities, the reason they can take things like certain kinds of compostable plastics is because they have a high enough heat. But it sounds like I could just put this in my backyard compost, it sounds
Yeah.
like. Very cool. Someone thinks soon, so the programs are coming soon. I used to work in green waste management in Vancouver, so I was part of the launch of the green bin program there. I don't even remember
Oh,
what year that
awesome.
was, but I if you this is super random, but if you look up on Instagram hashtag waste sort nerd, that's me, all of those posts, because I used to do waste sorting for a living.
That's so
I
cool.
used to jump into bins, got paid to jump into dumpsters and sort all the waste. So this is also definitely tangenting just into my like nerdy compost brain, but I think it's just so interesting and I love it. I love what you're doing so much. So thank you for what you are doing. And very cool in terms of your vision. I think we can all really get behind that. So as an entrepreneur in this space, you've already talked a little bit about like what that the journey has looked like working in this space and like the lessons learned along the way. And was this kind of your first foray into entrepreneurship? Or were you kind of entrepreneurial minded all along, or what does that look like, that journey?
Yeah, so this was my first venture ever. And I actually never thought that I would go into entrepreneurship when I came to school in Edmonton. So I'm originally from Ontario, from like the Greater Toronto area. And I came to Edmonton for school. And when I came here, I always thought that I would just try and get into medicine. And that was like the goal, to be a pediatrician. But after working in Hempact at first, and then like once we officially launched our venture, I saw that there's so much potential to what we're doing that like I think that's what I'm passionate about. Really making change with our product and also with our company, just in the outreach that we can do, and realizing like that's what I really want out of a career, like to make that sort of impact. And entrepreneurship is the perfect vehicle for that because, at the end of the day, like there are so many problems that I think entrepreneurship can solve. And that is like what's really inspiring to me about, entrepreneurship. So that's kind of like my little journey into it.
I love it. You're speaking my language so much. My degree was in health sciences,
Oh, awesome.
and at the end I went into environmental health as my kind of focus, and then I found entrepreneurship afterwards many years later, and it was just like, yes, this is how I could make the impact I wanted to make, because I was always wanting to be in public health. And it's like, you can, like you're saying, you can do so much education, and I get to amplify people like yourself, so it's very exciting. So in that journey then, this being your first venture and being in like a difficult space and living through 2020 while you're launching this as well, what are some tips you have for other entrepreneurs who might be starting out now, today?
I think like one thing that has always been helpful for me to remember and keep in mind is just the main reason why you started and the main reason like what your vision is for the company that you're launching or the idea or project that you're doing. Because there are so many times where you'll hear a no or you'll experience problems that seem insurmountable. But I think the biggest thing is remembering like why you're doing it, because at the end of the day, there are like, different solutions for different problems, but what makes your solution unique is really like why you're doing it and your driving purpose. So I think that's something that I really held on to. And then as a like a more like practical day-to-day type thing, what I do to like stay organized is I have a notebook like right here where it's literally just scrap paper, but I write down like everything that comes to mind. Because throughout the day, like even if I'm studying or doing other things, like little things come. I just work really well with doing things on paper, and I'd recommend it to people, even if you're very techie. Like, there's something special about like writing things down. Yeah. Yeah, exactly. So, I think those are some things that I think are helpful.
And I feel like I don't know if this happens to you, but like when you wake up, sometimes I wake up in the morning and I have like something's come to mind, is like, oh, that's how I want to frame that marketing campaign, or that's how I want to do that. That's how my pitch needs to go, whatever that is. And just kind of like being able to jot that down. And our brains like connect better when we write it down. So very cool. Yeah, I think that's great around knowing and coming back to your vision. I was also noodling on this recently, and that was also what I came to in terms of like, there are so many voices and there's so many people, and it sounds like you probably came up against those people saying exactly what they said at the pitch event. What about all these competitors? What about this? What about that? Like, what about ick factor? Like the opposite side of it. What about that ick factor element? And there's just so many, or you come against it, like you come up against like real things that you can't, you have to pivot. You can't get over those things. Like if you were trying to create tampons and then realize actually we can't do that right now anyways. So I think like coming back, like you're saying, coming back to that vision, I think that is really important. And doing, even just going through that exercise and going back to that exercise ever so often, once a year, every couple of years, having that, taking that space. I know it's not like the practical day-to-day element, but I think it's really, really important for us to be doing that. And so I really appreciate you bringing that up. And I appreciate you bringing up like the big thing and then like the day-to-day kind of element. Both are really important to keep in mind. So yeah, absolutely. And what was I going to say? What was I going to say? Lessons learned. Yes. Okay. So another thing, I know we're kind of getting to the like latter half of our conversation here today. So also again, if you're watching here live or later, please do feel free to comment or submit any questions. Sometimes people don't know that they're allowed to engage. You are definitely allowed to engage and say hello and submit your questions. So what I was going to ask was around, I think we're like really getting the sense of your values, and you mentioned to me before that this element of making sustainable living easy and accessible is something that's really important to you. And I'd love to know a little bit more about what that means to you, like within a Ruth or even outside of Ruth. Yeah, just like I'd like to give you some space to speak about that. What would you like us to hear here today?
Thanks, Shannon. This
Someone
mug
saying
was
they
giving me
love
it had like a little winky
love the
face on
mug. Love it.
it. I think when it comes to making like sustainable living easy, I think the way that I've started to come and realize like sustainable living doesn't have to be like this whole separate lifestyle or like this whole separate thing. And I think like even when it comes to making different choices dietary wise. So last year, I had a New Year's resolution of trying to eat less meat because I do really have cravings for chicken wings or ribs. And it's not the most environmentally friendly to be eating meat products all the time. So a small thing that I did was I made a New Year's resolution not to buy meat from the grocery store, but I would have meat like if I went out to eat or bought something from a restaurant. So I wasn't like completely cutting it out, but it was like a small change that like it made sense to even adopt it into my lifestyle because cooking meat is sometimes like it takes more time and it's more expensive. So there are benefits like all around that I found just by taking it off of my grocery list. And other things that I thought about, like I saw this other thing recently where someone was talking about how when they're leaving the grocery store, they just put all the products onto their cart and they don't bag it, but they have boxes that they keep in their car and then they'll just unload it right into the boxes. So it's more convenient because you're not awkwardly like waiting for the products to be bagged or bagging the products yourself with plastic bags at the grocery store. But then it's more convenient for you to take it into your house or wherever you are afterwards. So yeah, I always think like there are these small things that can save money, can save time. There are benefits to doing things in a sustainable way that are not so hard and like such like I feel like the categorizing of it sometimes can be intimidating to people, like saying like, oh, I have to like do everything ever to be sustainable. But no, like I think making the small differences that are easy, they do matter.
Absolutely. Yes. If anyone is looking for like a really great book on this, there's a book called The Future We Choose. Have you heard of that one?
No, I haven't.
So it's quite good because it does present like a positive, it presents like a negative potential outcome, and as well as a positive one that is very uplifting. And how they end the book, I listened to an audiobook. It was really good, an audiobook, because it has two speakers. It's quite good, the two authors. And at the end, they talk about creating your kind of 10-year plan. Like, if you were to envision 10 years from now, what if we wanted to get to that like really beautiful, positive version of the future? If we want to get to that and we had to do X, Y, and Z, and you want to become this person 10 years from now, what are the small steps? Like, you also don't have to do it all tomorrow. Like what you're saying, this year, I'm going to start eating out, only having meat when I go out to a restaurant. Next year, I'm going to start really trying to gr get compostable products for blah, 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 for instance, my menstruation cycle, or whatever it happens to be. Like, it doesn't have to be these big things, and it can be something that you do over time. Like, you look at like, okay, I'm going to do an audit of my house this year, and then next year I'm going to think about this. Like, it doesn't have to happen today. And I think that was a really powerful and important message from that book. I really highly recommend that. And there's lots of other resources out there. And it's also really cool when you find products like Ruth, though, that you're like, I can get behind this. This is like a really cool small business in Canada or wherever you happen to be in the world. I'm in Ireland right now. So finding these kind
Of
of
course.
like amazing small businesses and being like, I want to support this, like package free shop and some things they do, and like being like, that's a really cool, like this is like a beautiful something that I want to have that I can then replace my like icky plastic version of it and use this forever and it's beautiful and it's in my home and whatever. Like it's starting to think about like replacing things and cutting back things in different, more accessible ways, like you're talking about. Someone's saying the begging waiting time is the worst. Wow, that's honestly a great solution. I'm a super dork and I wear a backpack into the store. So I always have like a bag that's actually filled. My backpack is filled with bags.
Oh,
So because I used to always forget my little bags all the time, but I don't forget my
nice.
backpack for some reason. It doesn't look cool, but I also live in rural Ireland and I don't care. So I'm just like, cool, I get to like go in there
I
with my
feel like
backpack.
backpacks are so cool. They're so useful.
Yes, I agree. I totally wear them all the time. So and it's something to me that was easier to remember than all the little bags. But all my little bags happen to be in there. So you gotta find what works for you, don't you?
I love
Yeah.
that. I'm gonna write down the book you recommended, The Future
We
You Choose.
choose. I think it's we choose, you choose. I don't know. You'll find it. It's we or you. I've had friends who have read it who really liked it. And then there's also, because I think there's like some, I think there's maybe like a check, like a actual activity you can do, but otherwise the audiobook is fantastic as well. So highly recommend. And okay, so what can we're all on board. We understand the origin story. We're super on board. We love Ruth. So what can we as your audience do to support you? What's your ask here today of us?
Yeah, well, if these products are interesting to you, or you know someone who menstruates who would be interested in trying an eco-friendly sanitary pad, check out our website, getruth.ca, or our Instagram, and you can sign up for pre-sales. We are taking orders for people who are interested in getting their hands on the very first set of products. So, yeah, we're just waiting for you guys. Feel free to come and join us.
Amazing. And how can people get in touch with you directly or specifically?
They can always send a DM.ca, or
Perfect.
they can check out our website. We have like an email contact, and we'll get back to you, or I'll get back to you.
Amazing. Yes, and if you have friends who are interested, send them your way or their way as well. Not my way, their way as well. And share this this IG live. It's going to be on IGTV and it's going to be on YouTube. So please do share it out. Give Anka some love and Ruth some love. Talk about what they're doing. Honestly, like sharing and commenting seems little, but it's not. It's really great for businesses, especially who have just done a rebrand and have just launched new channels. So please do make sure to get on those for them. So is there anything that we didn't get to talk about here today that you had wanted to mention?
No, I don't think so. I think we covered everything. I really appreciate this opportunity, Melanie. This is awesome.
Fantastic. I'm so happy. And I'm so happy that it was your first one where you were being interviewed here today. That's been a real kind of what I'm trying to say. That's happened a lot over the last year. I think we're still all learning how to do these kinds of things. So I love being here for that first one too. And I'm just really glad that I got to meet you more one-on-one, because pitch events are always, there's so much going on. So I love having this time to get to know you a bit better and get to know your product, or more about your company and your story. So thank you so much. And thank you so much to everyone who came here and who have been commenting. I see like 1,000 heart bubbles going up the side here. So that's always really like encouraging to see. So love to see that. Thank you so much, everyone. These are typically happening on a weekly basis, or there's 3 or 4 of them per month, on what is this, Tuesday, I think, on Tuesdays, typically at 11:30 a.m. PST. And we're actually also rebranding and launching a new website in the next like week and a half. So all of our events will actually live on our events page then. Fancy that. So it'll be volitionadvisors.com/events and you can learn about all of our upcoming events. But in the meantime, thank you so much for coming. Make sure to check out the other founder chats because there's so many amazing founders in this community and just people in this community in general. I really appreciate it. Thank you so much for your time, Anka, and for everything that you're doing at Ruth. It's really cool. Make sure to keep us in the loop as to what you're doing.
Yeah, definitely. Thank
Thank you
you.
so much. Bye,
Have a good one.
everyone.